homeless services center or shelter is proposed, significant pushback from the surrounding community either delays, moves, or disposes of the project. How can the county work to ensure that projects such as the one proposed for the National Guard Armory in Atascadero move forward with more success? Ellen, this starts with you.
Right now, the county has a program to house 70 people. And it sounds like a good deal, but the reports tell us that there's 1,000 people who are unsheltered every night. So that's not really meeting the mark. I'm sure everybody here would like to have those 900 plus people also have housing. So what I think about is, why aren't we doing more than 70? What is the budget priority? And from what I understand, the incumbent's budget priority is roads. And when I talk to the community, that's not their priority. Their priority is taking care of our community.
I just have to say, it's one of my favorite stories working here at the county. It was great. The Regional Transit Authority needed a property for a new bus maintenance center, and Capsule needed to identify a new location that wasn't so controversial for the new homeless services center. And those two agencies, and I sat on the board of both, but they were able to come together, purchase the property together, a 9-acre piece of property over on Prado that really wasn't usable except for two little building envelopes, and then build the homeless services center we see now with all the services. Even has a dog kennel.
Board of Supervisors voted to raise inclusionary housing fees in order to boost the funding available for affordable housing in the county. The move is expected to be temporary. What should the county's next steps be to boost the supply of affordable housing as well as the money available to help fund it?
A new state law has been enacted that that exempts a lot of the extra fees that are put on normally on residential houses if you're under 750 square feet. Atascadero has a new development with small homes, 600 square feet. They're saving approximately $30,000 right off the top with that kind of a design build. And I hope to see more developments come in like that so that our starter houses and our workforce housing can be more affordable to our young people and our seniors.
We can't build our way out of this. And if government is going to step in and help, then we need to have partners and we need to strategize on what we're going to do. This will take political will. This means that sometimes we will have to make decisions that may go against some of rigid thinking that we might have been holding on to. And then we also need to create a funding stream. The county has started the process of figuring out how we can come up with housing. And we need to generate about $4 million a year so we can make a dent in this. And this will help builders, nonprofit builders, to leverage that money so we can get the units built.
We recently adopted a groundwater sustainability plan for the Paso Robles groundwater basin. But some in the agricultural community complained that the county did not conduct adequate outreach and that the plan lacks solutions aside from pumping cutbacks. What do you think of the Paso Basin plan, and what are your priorities for water management in the 5th District going forward? Ellen, we'll start with you.
My number one priority is to bring the basin back to sustainability. And I think we need to be creative and we need to have the farmers involved in that process. We get there by metering. Metering is not even mentioned in the plan. We get there by, and we have to meter. You have to measure what we are pumping. Second thing we need to do is best management practices. And this is a collaborative effort. We need projects that will decrease our reliance on the basin, and we need to have reasonable and fair efforts to limit water use.
And I disagree with my opponent here. The Paso Robles groundwater basin is one of the largest aquifers in the United States, and it really does have a lot of groundwater to give. But what we saw during the drought years is a lot of a large investment coming in and just planting by the tens of thousands of acres, and we saw a decline in the water table. At the same time, the state was recognizing statewide that this has been going on for many decades all over the state of California, to the point it was even causing subsidence in many counties where the ground was collapsing underneath. So when we talk about environmental sustainability, we have to do something about that. I serve on many, many boards representing you, the transportation agency, I sit on SinCal with public health issues, our air pollution control district, our integrated waste management, dealing with the waste and the issues that surround our landfills. Every day, working with people, veterans, seniors, children's programs, neighborhoods, but always working towards trying to make this county a better place. And my work, and I do work hard at this, my work has earned me the support of our sheriff, Ian Parkinson, our district attorney, Dan Dow, and our county assessor, Tom Bordero, and many other county leaders that I've had the privilege to work with.
There is one thing we can agree on, that this is a wonderful place. This is an extraordinary population that lives here. And as extraordinary people, you deserve extraordinary leadership as well, one that reflects your values. I believe Ms. Arnold has let us down. She's partially responsible for where we're at today with some of the issues that we talked about. I believe she is out of step with our community. She's not supporting our families. She's turning away economic opportunity. She's threatening jobs and prosperity. And she supports oil development. She supports recreation over public health in the Pomo. These are things that I cannot support.